Hi, I'm Brad, and welcome again to another one of my online content videos for my Music Humanities class. This one we're going to be talking about Beethoven again. This time we're going to be talking about late Beethoven. In fact, we're just going to talk about one piece, and we'll be discussing this even more in class. Just to give you some sense of where this is. Again, here's that era that I've labeled Beethoven. We're in the 1820s, 1830s, you know, when he died, 1832, I think. And the Romantic era is beginning to really take hold, you know, the 19th century. But Beethoven was the guy. He's the guy that made that happen. He's the kind of the Ur model that a lot of Romantic theorists and people like that pointed to. So, the Ninth Symphony. This is one of my favorite pieces of music. It's just incredible. You know, I'm not going to really go through the form or anything like that. I just want to walk you through the piece itself and just give you a sense of what this was about. Because, I mean, at this point, he's taking great liberties with any form anyhow. I mean, a lot of people thought he was crazy, that, you know, he just had lost his mind. But a lot of people also, on the other side of the fence, said that this is just an absolute work of genius. The second half kind of work kind of went out over the long run. You have to imagine Beethoven was the rock star of the time. I mean, the rock star. People knew of him. They knew of his work. You know, everything he did was kind of a major event. And this, the premiere of the Ninth Symphony, promised to be the major event for a long time. People had heard that he was working on this incredible piece. And you have to imagine what it must have been like to walk into the concert hall, and in front of you was a huge orchestra, you know, one of the largest orchestras that you've probably seen. Sitting behind the orchestra was a huge choir, one of the largest choirs that you've seen. And sitting on the stage were four soloists, you know, substantial German people that, you know, were all, not just one soloist, but four soloists. And they sat there. So you came in, and Beethoven conducted it, came out, and stood up, and started the Ninth Symphony. And this is the first thing you heard, okay? Again, this is an allegro. You know, theoretically, it's in sonata allegro form, but yeah, it's kind of all over the map. And you're imagining it's going to be like a typical big Beethoven beginning. Well, it is, but not how you imagined it. This is the start of the Ninth Symphony. Yeah, that's not like the start of any piece you've heard. You know, it just emerges out of nothingness. This is just like, you know, people going, it's just like the dawn of the universe, you know. I mean, and he's just playing very simple notes, you know, just like a fifth, dee-da, da-da, dee-da, kind of over and over again. And then you hit this big, boom, clamorous sound. You go, whoa, now it's going to start. It's going to really take off. And here's what Beethoven does. Yeah, he goes back and he starts it all again. But But this time when the big chord comes in, he's modulated it. So it's in like a different key. It's just amazing. I could take you through this whole first movement, but we won't because we have other things to cover. Please just listen to it on the website. This piece just is, it's just an incredible work. All right, so now we've gone through the first movement. Notice it's like almost 20 minutes long. That's longer than almost the entirety of a typical four movement Mozart or Haydn symphony. You know, this is a major, major work. Second movement. Now, typically, this would be the slow movement, the reflective movement, but it's marked molto vivace, which means very, very fast. And in fact, it is. Here it is. It's just a rollicking piece of music. And I don't know if you caught it. You know, people are saying, well, Beethoven, he doesn't know how to write, you know, in forms anymore. This is a very, it's a form we know. Okay, I'm going to point out again. Also, I mean, the cool stuff, you know, the drum solo, for God's sake. Bum, 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 you know, but listen to what this is, and I'll point out some aspects of it, okay? Okay, here we start. That's number two. That's number three. That's number four. It's a fugue. It's a very strict four-voice fugue, you know, as good as anything that Bach might have written, you know, and Beethoven's just saying, oh, Beethoven, I can write a fugue, no problem, you know, and so it's just like, you know, all of a sudden the audience is going, whoa, and it's just an amazing piece of music. So we're going to go on to the third movement. Finally, we get to the one, you know, after, you know, 40 minutes or so of music, we get to the third movement, 30 minutes, you know, where it's finally some slowness. And this is just one of those soaring Beethoven melodies, you know, that he's just famous for doing. So after pounding you on the head for like 30 or 35 minutes, you just come up with this la da 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 da. Yeah, it's just amazing, you know. And you just sit there and relax. Now, bear in mind that orchestra is up there, but that choir is still sitting there. Those four soloists have been sitting there. You're only about two-thirds of the way through, and you only have one movement left to go. The fourth movement of Beethoven's Symphony No. 9. Here's how it starts, and I'm going to kind of skip through this quite a bit to show you some different parts, because this is a massive, massive work, okay? So it starts out with a very dissonant chord. You know, where's it going to go from here? Well, it goes to a place that nobody expected. Uh, a solo passage of just the cellos and the basses. And this is no longer, you know, the question and answer. You know, this is a declamation of universal truth. And again, we're going to hit that big, big dissonant chord again. Now, Beethoven's about to do something here that nobody had done before. Remember, the four movements of a symphony are kind of like four little pieces that are kind of separate from each other. Beethoven is meaning this to be an integrated artwork. And here's how he does it. Yeah, it's the first movement sneaking in. But it gets interrupted. And now, there's the second movement sneaking in. But those cellos and basses, they keep on declaiming. And here comes, ready, the third movement. Oh my. So again, this is unprecedented. You know, I mean, people are going, what's the form here? What's going on? You know, and then finally we get to the point where the cellos and basses are going to tell you what this piece is about. Again, it's still just cellos and basses, you know, and this is one of the coolest melodies ever written, you know, and it's just kind of putting it out there. Now, I'm going to run it ahead because he's going to take some time here, and he's going to build this up, and he's going to build it up a little bit, and we're going to get to this part right about... So there's the big statement of this melody. Now again, we've still got that huge choir sitting back there, you know, and we've got the soloist sitting back there. And slowly they start to stand up, okay? And you're going to hear a really big dissonant chord coming, one of those things that Beethoven throws in. And then, let me get this set here. You'll see one of the soloists stand up. Here comes the chord. Thank you. So what's he singing there? You know, after that big dissonant chords, he sings, "Oh friends, not these tones. Let us sing more cheerful songs and more joyful." And then the choir stands up, and wait to hear when they say joy, okay? You know, joy, joy. And finally, you're getting the force of this thing. And now he's going to go into that melody and he's going to sing. This is by Schiller, by the way. Oh my, and then here comes the other solos in a second. Just, you know, again, imagine hearing this for the first time. You know, we've all heard this, I think, you know, because this is one of Beethoven's most famous works outside of maybe the Fifth Symphony. And it's just incredible. Promise me, if you ever get a chance to go hear this performed, you will go and do it, because it's an experience that you just can't repeat. And the feelings of just sheer joy that come out of this, it's amazing. Well, I'm going to take you through a little bit more. Beethoven then goes from there through some various things, and he winds up with this thing called the Turkish March, you know, which he kind of throws in the middle for the heck of it. And here comes another one of the soloists. Here comes the choir again. He goes through this insane fugal part where he's just showing that, you know, he can just compose about anything he wants to, you know. And finally, it winds its way back around, and you're finally to this part. I'm gonna stop it there. Again, go listen to the rest of this on the website. It's just amazing, you know. And these words, you know, again, they're Schiller's words, but Beethoven's setting of them, you know, all men become brothers where your gentle wing rests. You know, this is a song of universal integration. You know, it's something we need as a species. And Beethoven is just putting it out there, and we're just listening to it and going, whoa, this is incredible. Now, here's the thing. Beethoven was profoundly ill when he wrote this. The last few years of his life were not pleasant. He was suffering from various ailments, you know, probably from bad wine, you know, bad food, you know, whatever. And he was profoundly deaf. He couldn't hear anything. They had to turn him around to see the audience applauding when they finished this. What does that say? We'll talk about it later.